listen to the voices that are out there. And we have to learn not to get on the bandwagon for what we hear out there. But I want you to hear this word. I'm looking for those of you who like to follow the Bible. I'm using the New King James Version. And I'm using 2 Chronicles chapter 7. And I'm lifting for your hearing verses 12, 13, and 14. Verse 12. Then the Lord appeared to Solomon by night and said to him, I have heard your prayer and have chosen this place for myself as a house of sacrifice. When I shut up heaven and there is no rain, and command the locusts to devour the land and send the pestilence among my people, and verse 14, if my people, who are called by my name, will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and heal their land. I'm going to read that again. That is your message today. I need you to read that whole seventh chapter when you go home from 2 Chronicles. And the Lord wants to do some things that save Paul. And he can't do it without you. So even as Solomon was praying for the temple, because they had rebuilt the temple, he was concerned about that. The Lord wants to do a rebuilding here.
My Lord.
But he's depending on you. You're waiting for somebody else, but he's depending on you. And when the Lord gave me the message, I said, well, this is for St. Paul. I'm going to read it again, beginning with verse 12. But you begin when you start reading the beginning of the chapter and go through to the end. Verse 12. Then the Lord appeared to Solomon by night and said to him, I have heard your prayer, and I've chosen this place for myself as a house of sacrifice. When I shut up heaven, and there is no rain, or command the locusts to devour the land, or send pestilence among my people. Verse 14. If my people are, how many are God's people?
Hallelujah.
If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and see my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and heal their land. If my people who are called by will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and forgive their sin and heal their land. How many want a healing up here in St. Paul? You have to be part of it. It won't happen unless you take it personally. How many willing to make a change? All the members of St. Paul stand up. All of you who are members, stand up right now. Wherever you are, stand up as St. Paul is. And the ones who are not here, who've been coming every once in a while, you know, they need to be here. I've been coming to St. Paul for a long time. A whole lot of conferences, a whole lot of pastors. You may be seated. Just want you guys to see who's in the house. But this message is for those who are not part of St. Paul. You can use this anyway. You know, so the Lord is calling us to do some things. And the Lord gave me a few subjects, and I think you can work with it. The prescription to receive God's blessings and favor. The prescription. The prescription. And then also the Lord gave me the formula. It works together. You can use this prescription to receive God's blessings and favor, or you can say the formula. Whatever works for you, that's what you do. But if you want God's best, you want to turn around in your marriage, in your relationships, in everything, this is the prescription. You can take an outline and you can work it for yourself. Solomon has been careful in building the new temple. He has made sacrifices and spent time alone with God. Solomon knew how to pray. Solomon's prayer reached the heart of God. Solomon is not selfish. He prays for the needs of the people. Sometimes we pray for our needs. He prays for the needs of the people. God hears and gives him the prescription or the formula. So he's the one who prays. He's the pastor. Pastor Stembridge prays all the time for me and Sister Stembridge. And the leader is the one. We can't have 50 kinds of formulas for one thing that God wants to do. We have to look at the man of God or the woman of God. What is the Lord saying at this time that he wants to have done? So when I thought about this, Reverend, I thought about whoever was here before, it's a new day. We have to forget the past and move on to the future. And once we forget forget the past. God can use us to do some new things. And that's in your life, in your school, in your marriages, in whatever it is that's going on. But first, the Lord tells us we have to learn to humble ourselves. We can't be haughty. We can't be high and mighty. We can't feel that, you know, I deserve this and all of that. But the Lord says us, you got to be humble. Solomon was that kind. You remember when Solomon came into all of this, and he, when the Lord wanted to give him so much, and way back you can go back and read some other things. And most of you remember that story of the mothers, the two harlots who were in the house, and we really knew the test of what he had prayed. He prayed for wisdom because he admitted he didn't know how to rule and to manage God's people. But he asked for wisdom. When we take low and we ask for wisdom, because even if you have, if you're a billionaire, if you don't have any wisdom, you're not going to have any money, very nice. Yeah. You got to have some wisdom to know how to use what God has given you to use. And so the Lord wants you to get the right prescription for your marriage, for your relationship with your children. Some of you don't know how to be soft and caring and kind. Some people don't know how to talk to children. And just because you're taller or bigger than someone, that sometimes you have to bow down and come down low. I taught school for over 30 years, and I understand. I understand having grown up in the hood, growing up in Newark. And we asked the question about Nazareth. Can anything good come out of Nazareth or Newark or wherever you live, you put yourself in? I came out of it. How many of you came out of a situation that people felt that you weren't going to turn out right? You weren't going to be anything. But look, you're still here. You're surviving. And the Lord has allowed you to be here. And even as Solomon prayed for wisdom early on, he still has wisdom. And he's praying, and he knows that one of these days, and right now, when we think about what's going on in America, what's going on around the world, what's going on with the various hurricanes that are on us, the first thing we must do is not humble ourselves. Yes. Not blame it on somebody else. Now, we can get very spiritual, and we try to figure out why something is going on. If something happens, we say, well, the Lord is paying him back, and this we name a whole lot of stuff. We do a whole lot of things that the Lord has nothing to do with. We have to learn to humble ourselves, and we have to make sure that we have the right prescription, and we have to learn to sing praises to God. And in this house, you know how to sing the praises. I notice when I come that the choir sings, and even at the times that I've been here to worship. But you don't have to wait till you come to church to praise God and worship. Sometimes you can sing the scripture. Read the word and you begin to sing it unto the Lord, and you don't have to worry about what kind of voice you have.
That's right.
If you have to sing in the bathroom or wherever, by yourself in your car, you can sing unto the Lord. And nobody will say you're off key and you're supposed to be in the key of C and you're somewhere else. But it's one of those chords, those strange chords, you know. But you can sing unto the Lord. So the Lord tells us, he tells you, he tells me, humble yourselves. Worship God, for God is a great God. God is a good God. Has it been good to you? Let me just say this. In knowing I was coming here, Reverend, a lot of people might have said, you need to stay home and rest. You don't need to get up 5 o'clock every Sunday morning like you do, and you're going over to St. Paul. You can stay home and just go to St. Paul. So when I was home last night, and I knew the message and all of that, and I said, Lord, what would you have me to do? I said, tell you what. When I decided, Reverend, I got a little tired after doing some things during the day. I said, I'm not going to eat and go to sleep. I said, when you go to sleep, I'm not going to set any alarm. And when I wake up, then I'll eat. So I woke up about 9 o'clock last night. And I decided to get a little something to eat. Because I said, I don't know how long I'm going to be up. You know? And so the Lord let me do what I needed to do. And then I went to sleep. And I said, now, I'm still trying. I want to go to St. James this morning. But I'm not going to be a foolish woman. If you don't give me the strength, and if I feel weak, I won't go. So I got up this before the alarm went off. I usually wake up before the alarm goes off. I woke up this morning. I set the alarm about 5 o'clock or something. I woke up a quarter to 5 this morning. So I said, Lord, I think you really want me to go. You know, got myself ready. And even before I got to St. James, I sent the pastor a little text. Now, let me say this to some of us who think we're always in charge. Yes, I'm pastor. Yes, I'm the senior elder at St. James. Yes, I've been ordained as an itinerant elder since 1964. But there's a way to do things. And so I don't have to ask permission to come here. And I really don't ask, but I usually send a message. When I came back from a retreat about a year ago, I said, the Lord has kind of revived me. And I know that when I leave St. James on Sunday morning, wants me to do more ministry. Because, see, I'm from old school. I used to be in church all day. I'm a product of revival. Mary Watson Stewart was my mom in ministry when she came to St. James years ago. So I'm used to being in church all day. I don't understand this church. We can't get people to... Some of you here have never been to an annual conference. You think it's enough church to come on Sunday and you don't know about... But back in the day, we went to church in the morning. We stayed at Sunday school. Alan, Christian, and Beverly, everything was wrapped up in the church. It was in the choir. And one time way back at St. James, we had 80 young people singing in the choir. Whoa. We do all of that. We went to church at night. So I don't have a problem about church. I don't mind being in church. And so I'm just thanking the Lord. So this morning I sent him a text. I meant to send it by 6:45. And so I was even in the car on my way going to church. That's almost still, I didn't have time because I wanted to be in both places. Send him a text, good morning, Pastor. And I usually call all the pastors at St. James. I don't, good morning, Pastor. I said, I will be going to St. Paul. Did they pray for me? That was it. Sometimes you tell too much. How many know we get too much information? I said, I'm going to St. Paul today. And that's what I did. You, many times, you tell too much. You give too much information. When you see somebody downtown, you don't have to tell. Oh, I saw so-and-so downtown. Maybe they want to be downtown. They didn't have to be doing anything, but we try to tie, you know, tie the ribbons and put the dots together. Sometimes we get too much information. Humble yourself. Yes, so I'm at St. James, but I know I don't go higher than leadership. I'm a pastor, but I don't go higher than the pastor. I may not agree with everything, but I'm a team player.
Amen.
Okay? And I have to remember that I'm clergy. Mm-hmm. And I can't share everything else with late. Mm-hmm. Some things people don't need to know. Mm-hmm. You know, some things I'll say I have to take to my grave. Nobody will ever know. Mm-hmm. And a whole lot of stuff I know. But I don't let people know that I know. Yeah. I just sit there and when I go places. And one of the things I want to say is, most of the times when you see me, I don't have to be up here. If you know you want me to do something, I'm in your church. How come you can't have the Spirit of the Lord lead you? Say, I want you to pray. I want you to do this. So when I go into church, especially when I go to St. Luke, Reverend will come over and say, Reverend, come and pull me. I said, I'm right here. Because I think if the Lord is leading you to ask me to pray or read the scripture, ask me to pray or read the scripture. I had somebody at St. James before. They said, I'd like to be up there. I said, why do you want to go up in the pulpit? Don't give a chance. Some people just want to be in a high place. You don't. That's not even right. Why do you want to be up there? I don't have to be up there. And way back then, you did not come inside that little chance until you were ordained.
That's right.
Everybody's everywhere now. Everybody wants some kind of recognition. The Lord says, humble yourself. Yes. Even when your name's not called.
Yes.
Don't stop coming to church because your name's not called. That's one way you can humble yourself. Worship your time. Yes. And on your job. Even if you don't like the job.
Yes.
It's paying your rent, doing what you need to do. You may not like the supervisor may not like you. Do what you need to do because you know what you need. The Lord says, humble yourself. What does worship cost you? Do you come out during the time, during the week? Do you give them your tithes and offering? You're not giving it to Reverend Stembridge. Well, I don't know what they do with the money. It's not your business. And Mary Watson Stewart used to say, you can throw it in the river. I gave my money. And that's up to that person and God. God will deal with them.
Yes.
Do what you're supposed to. I made my mind. I'm not going to owe God any money.
Yes.
I have a young lady. Just to tell you, you know who she is. My little, very petite little lady I've known since she was 5 years. I was praying for her about 3 years to get a job. And one day I said to her, do you tithe? Well, I kind of knew the answer because even with my ministry, I remember never giving me anything. And I've done a whole lot of buying her since she was 5. She said, well, I had to do this, and I had to do that. She drives a BMW. She paid cash for it when she got it. She bought it. It was not a new car, but she takes care of it. But some people are just stingy like that. We wonder why we don't get the answer, why we don't get the husband or the wife. But are you stealing from God? You can't pay all your bills. I didn't have enough. You never have enough if you don't tithe. I've been tithing since I was very young. In relationships, God gave me Are you willing to submit to God's will, God's leading? Solomon recognized his limitations. He asked God for wisdom. He needed help in leading. Do you need help? Just think of where you are. What do you need help with? You won't ask for help because guess what? You don't want anybody to know you don't know it. But if you get up there and say the wrong thing, everybody's going to know that you don't know it. Amen? So you have to learn to submit yourself and don't be so proud. Even if a child gives you an answer, it could be the right answer, but you don't want to receive it. So you act like they didn't say anything because you have that pride. The Lord says, humble yourself. We all need God. Show me the way. I can do nothing without you, Lord. This morning when I got up and I was feeling a little weak because I probably had about 4 hours of sleep. But I said, Lord, I'm going to St. James. I just felt I needed to go to St. James. And guess what, Sister Tate? If I had not gone to St. James, you probably wouldn't have brought me over and you wouldn't be here. I didn't know she was coming. We have to make sure we're where God wants us. How many know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
You pray, and even when I travel or even when I'm doing, I don't have too many friends, Reverend, who can move on a dime. Mm-hmm. I can't. If I decide that the Lord wants me someplace, I can go. Most of the traveling I do, I'm by myself because people, I'll let you know, and most of the time they let you know they're not going anywhere. So I just go ahead and book my resume, do what I need to do, because at the bottom line, they're not going. And they may slow you down, okay? I want you to know that this walk with the Lord is not in the kind of us. We don't deserve anything. God has already done more than enough.
Yes.
All that we possess are blessings from God. That house you live in, that car you drive, even though you said you paid for it, the Lord gave you the strength to earn the money to get what you need to buy that thing. And some of you won't even have enough. And I'll say this. When I passed my pair, when we had, I'm not even going to say, she was missionary president. I'm not giving the name. You don't even know who she was. I said, she said, I was going to work, and lady asked me to drop off. She said, but I wasn't going that way. But she said she could hear the pastor say, go that way. So she took the lady, and that's what we all have to go out of our way.
That's right.
The woman of Samaria, I must needs go through Samaria. We can't be a blessing until we go out of our way.
Yeah.
To be a blessing to somebody.
Right.
And even after I had that dinner, at the home on the 17th of September. One of the young ladies, Monique, and she's been saying to me, Reverend, I like your greens. They tell me I'm pretty good. I like your greens. She's been telling me that for a while, but we hadn't figured the time out. She works out in the Morristown area. So she was busy on Saturday. So I tell you what, when you come from work, I'll help you with these greens. So what I did, I stopped at one of the ShopRite stores and I got some greens. And she, I'll tell you this, you can use any part of the turkey or the chicken you want, but I don't cook with turkey butts. I said, anything goes in the pits at home. But anyway, she likes the turkey butts. I said, I happen to have a big turkey wing, not a turkey wing, turkey neck in my freezer. So I took a big one. I said, she's lying, it doesn't have to have meat or whatever. So I took it out. She was going to come by at 6, so about 4 o'clock I put it all in for a slow cook. A whole lot of water and seasoned a little bit. And then when she came, I said, now we're going to do these greens. So I have those big, long pans that you cook, but not the, you know, the big ones. I said, I'm going to put one under the table. I washed the pans and everything. And I gave her a bag of greens. I said, all right, you work with these, and I work with these. And I showed her. And she didn't have too much in the pan by the time she was doing this. I said, hand me that pan. You take this one. We were working together, taking the stalks and all the stuff out. So we got those greens ready and put them in there, and we did what we needed to do. You have to go out of your way for people.
Mm-hmm.
Now I've been cooking since I was 12 because my mother was sick most of the time. So I learned to cook a long time ago. Didn't have to use a recipe,
amen,
but I can use the recipe and put my own touch. That's what we do.
Right.
She said, I like your greens. I said, well, see, when you come home and you want some greens, they don't have to taste like mine. You can cook them with or without me. It's no right or wrong way. It's to your taste.
Amen.
Amen?
Amen?
Okay. And so we got the greens. And she said, so she has the greens. I said, so when I need some greens prepared, I can get you some greens. And when I was at Emmanuel, I do carrots. humble ourselves. I know some people don't get in the kitchen, even when I passed it at Mocker. Whenever they had something out, I'm not saying, I don't know whether Sister Stembridge does any bacon or not, I don't know, that's not about her. But I've been doing this for a long time. I've become part of it. I don't mind putting somebody, put the member in my car. Some people don't do it. I have some pastor people right now, they wouldn't take their members anyway. You get there the best way you can. But see, I do that. Most of you don't know that I pastored in the hood. I pastored on Spruce Street in Newark. How many know where Spruce Street in Newark is? I grew up on Charles Street, just in case you didn't know. Between Spruce and Montgomery. So I knew Jake Green's down the corner. Anything you want, you can get it in my block. Anything you want, you can get it in my block. You got it, okay? And so what how the people are dressed in, whether they're trans, this or whatever, it was all, it was in my building, in my block. But it's not too many things that I don't know, but guess what? I had a whole lot of people who were praying at St. James, 6 o'clock, 12 o'clock. But when they wanted to bring me something, they said, the Lord called you to that ministry. He didn't call me. If you want, you come by St. James to pick it up. They wouldn't bring it over where I was. But guess what? When the drug deals went down, it wasn't when I was over there on Sunday morning or Tuesday. How many know that drug deals usually don't go down like that?
That's right.
I never got stuck on one of those elevators, those smell. They looked out for me. When you do God's business, how many know they'll take care of me? A white old man, okay? My car would sit there, they wouldn't touch it. Nobody bothered anything. You gotta humble yourself and submit yourself to the Lord. I said to the Lord, I surrender my will and my way to you. And I said to the Lord, whatever you're doing in this season, don't do it without me. That's what I said. Whatever you're doing in this season, don't do it without me. Lord, what do you need me to do?
Yes.
And one of my daughters was saying to me the other day, she said, when they asked me to clean the toilets, and before, and she was a minister, she said, the others wouldn't do it, but he said, would you do it? And then it came a time that she was really going through. And the minister called her in the office and said, this is for you. And she looked at it, the tears came. It was $1,000. He said, you know, I know that you have some needs. And when the others wouldn't do it, I watched you. Whenever I asked you to do something, you did it.
Mm-hmm.
It's not just about being up here preaching or doing something. God, whatever we do, let's do it unto the Lord.
That's right.
Whether it's in the kitchen, whether it's in the toilets, wherever it is. Because you can always wash your hands. You can always sterilize stuff. Put on your clothes. You see, when you put that white on, that's shouting clothes. That's victory clothes. You can't be in the kitchen and doing all the things in white. White is what you put on when you have the victory. So it's not an entitlement when you see people doing well and for all the other things. God is calling us to offer ourselves, visit ourselves, humble ourselves. And then, in 2 Chronicles, it tells us to humble ourselves. And then after we humble ourselves, it tells us what?
Pray.
I'm not going to ask for the show of hands, but if you're not praying, pray. The Lord says pray. In Luke 11:1-4, when Jesus taught the disciples, they said, teach us how to pray. How do we pray? When we pray, we say, our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Amen?
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our sins. For we also forgive everyone who is indebted to us. And do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. When we pray, we're sincere. God hears us. We have to learn how to pray. Pray when you send your children out to school. Pray when you get up in the morning. I learn myself every morning. In fact, I commune myself every morning. I'm one of them vocal. I do commune. It's not a thing that I feel guilty if I don't, but usually when I'm home, I will do communion. I'll pray. And Lord, I don't know what we're going to do together today, but what is it you want me to do? That's how I pray. Because you don't know what's going to be all you do in the day. So I pray before I leave. And I anoint myself every day before I leave the house to make sure I'm prepared for whatever is going to befall me. Any school teachers in the house, any educators in the house, raise your hand. And I had victory in my classroom because I gave it to the Lord. And what I did, I would get to the classroom early. I'd already anointed myself. I closed the door. Nobody had to know what I was doing. I prayed on everything in that room. Those difficult students, I anointed them seats. That's why they abused me. You know? I have a problem. I didn't put my hand on any of them. told Mr. Mercado, so at the end of the day, he came to the classroom. He said, come here. He said, did you tell Mrs. Williams? And the tears started coming down his face. He took him down the altar. You know, I didn't play. I mean, I'd be nice to you when, this, when it was warm weather or something. I'd get some juice. And I, when I went to Rutherford, they didn't know. How many in here know what was it? Bread pudding. How many know what bread pudding is? Now, all black folks mostly know what bread pudding is. Who doesn't know what bread pudding is? You might be ashamed. Who doesn't know what bread pudding is? Stand up. Anybody here? You're not in, you were standing anyway, right? He was already standing. Okay, when I went to Rutherford, I say this. We were doing a story, and it had bread pudding in there. And remember, I told you, nobody looked like me. So I said, and I had them to tell me what they thought bread pudding was. And they were talking about you get some bread, and you pour the pudding on top of it, and they were doing all this stuff. And finally, I decided I need a big pan of bread pudding. I made the bread pudding and took it there. Nice pan. And to just think, young people and children, they like a little stuff. I like my dessert at room temperature. So I warmed it, and I got some, like, Cool Whip, you know, and let them, I said, here's my requirement. Don't put your hand, what you touch is what you take. And that doesn't mean touch the whole pan either. I'm good about it, you know. Because a lot of times where I work, a lot of them folk, they take a piece of bread. No, that's your bread. You don't have to take the bread out of the basket and hand it to me. You hand me the basket, and I'll put my hand on the bread that I... That's what you're supposed to do. Am I right? I baked and I did a whole lot of things. You have to share yourself. The Lord gives all of us gifts in here. We don't have to be a TD Jakes. We don't have to be anybody. The Lord only needs one.
That's right.
He needs you. And if you're willing to hear the call, to humble yourself and pray, and after you pray, the Lord says, seek my face. Seek God's face. Get an audience with God. Do you know how to get in close contact with God? Some time out. Not on your way out the door, you know. Lord, you know, after you pray in the morning or in the evening, whatever it is, just kind of shut yourself in with God and don't you do the talking. Just stay in God's presence. And as you're in God's presence, you're intentional. You put some effort. There's some preparation that you do. You know that nobody's, even if the phone rings, you're not going to jump up and answer the phone. You're going to be in God's presence. You're going to be persistent. And I say you have to be intentional. And you don't just come into God's presence without greeting Him. How do you address the president? He's not a dude. When you address the queen, there's a certain way that you address the queen or the king. When you're talking to a governor or somebody, you know, your honor or something. And one of the friends had to go to court, and before he got there, someone told him, he said, I know one thing, but this judge, you better pull up your pants before you go in there. What is it that you need to do to get an audience with God? What do you need to do, even on the job? Sometimes the way I see people dress, I go, Ryder, you're not getting that job. And a long time ago, people thought that, well, it's not about that, I can do anything, I need to do this. That has nothing to do with my work. Well, yes, it does. Because guess what? You may not get the job. You may go in and do everything. But when you leave out of there, your resume or your whatever you have, in whatever papers or anything, anything that your application is going in what I call file number 13, because you work out the door. When they say I'm going to call you, they will not be calling you. And this is the time when you go, if you get a job, go a little early and don't take 15 minutes more than you're supposed to take on your break. Don't be the first one out the door. Many times the Lord gives us what we need, but we mess it up. And my husband used to say, you mess up a bad lunch or something like that, or you can't ride in a broken down taxi cab. Yeah, we mess up a whole lot of stuff just by not studying to see what God wants. And just sometimes being quiet. Oh, wow. And if you don't know what to do, ask somebody. Now, I heard this. Now, I don't know how the brothers are, but I've heard that a man will ride around and won't tell you he's lost. Is that true? Is he more after that? Now, I don't know about that, but all I'm saying is that you see And then bottom line, after you do all that, you have to make sure that there's real regeneration, that you turn it around, that you're not living in that old way. It says, turn from your wicked ways. That means repentance. Whatever it is that you know is wrong, you know it's sin, you know it's, you shouldn't be doing that. And I'm old school. And you know, Reverend, even when I go to the professional people, no matter what office I go to, they buy in the house, they live together, then they get married. I don't know what kind of order that is. I'm serious. The whole structure today, it's not about God, it's what I want to do. I said to someone before that I was counseling. I said, you know, when I was sitting down and they said, they asked me, now I didn't try to get them. They read my book and they called the church and asked if I counseled. So when I sat down, I asked them, I said, do you live here? Oh, yeah, we do. Now, they really didn't need my counseling. Because my husband had said, he said, they already answered all the questions. That was his thing. They already answered all the questions. So I'm not meddling today, but the Lord needs to stir up a whole lot of stuff because guess what? Some of you need a blessing and you don't know why you're stagnant and in the same place that you've been over and over again, but you have to turn around. Turn from your wicked way. Everything that you know that's wrong, the Lord is calling you today to turn from that, anything right. that you know. And if you do that, God will bless you. As I'm talking to young people all the time, and I see them all the time, and part of the group that came to my house where Sister Tate helped me, they're looking for the mate. And I remember I said to someone years ago, are you expecting a mate? What are you doing in preparation for that? How are you getting ready for it? Have you cleaned out your closet? I said, well, go home and clean out your closet. A whole lot of people we learned that day, they have a whole lot of baggage. They're very needy. And let me say, ladies, the average person that you're meeting today, he goes both ways. He knows when he meets you that you want to go down the aisle. You can't be so needy. I've never been that kind of person that was desperate. I'm saying that to somebody. Don't be desperate. My husband had seen me a whole year before I knew he was looking. Because every time he came to Jersey, he lived in New York, every time he came to Jersey, I didn't know he was looking. And I just wasn't there. And I remember he was part of a Bethel Gospel Tabernacle out in Jamaica, New York. Bishop Caesar was his father in ministry. And I say this, and I'm close, we have time. Remember, I'm in charge, and the pastor said, I'm pastor there. He tried to meet me for that whole year, and he told one of the ladies at the church, because I was at Manhattan Bible Institute at the time. He said, when she goes up to get her degree, her diploma, point her out to me. I was Mary White then. So I guess when I got up, I learned about that afterwards. And I guess it looked all right. Because he's getting ready to go away. He said, I'm going away on vacation for 2 weeks, And if she's for me, she'll be here when I come back. He was from the Virgin Islands. So 2 weeks later, there was a revival out at Pastor Caesar's, out of Bethel. And a good friend, and most of the people in my wedding were pastors or ministers or something. I got this call and from this Reverend Hughes. He said, we have a revival out here. Now, he wasn't a member of that church. He lived in Jersey. He said, there's a revival out here. He said, would you like to go to the revival? And so it was a Thursday night that he called me. I said, he said, it closes out tomorrow night. I said, yes, sir, but I didn't know it was a setup. So then after he called me, to tell me about the revival, he called Johanna and he said, she's going to be there. Can you come? He said, I didn't plan to go back, but if she's going to be there, I'm coming. So he came back, and I was living in Newark on South 16th Street. He wasn't driving, because New Yorkers don't really need to drive. We met on 42nd Street. The friend who ended up being my maid of honor was in the car, and the person she ended up marrying. When I got in the car, he came in with the scripture. The Bible says you should not add or take to the take away from the word. In the presence of the Lord is fullness of joy, and at my right hand there will be pleasures forevermore. She's at my left hand.
Is that funny?
I got in the car. We were going to the revival. He said, I'm paying for everybody in the car. We're going to Junior's. How many heard about Junior's?
Yes.
He's out treating everybody. So we went to Junior's, and then he said, can I see you again? Now that, ladies, that's how I do it. I said, okay, you know, he wanted and my mother said when I was growing up, she said, I know she can't be a nun because we're not Catholic. I wouldn't come down off the steps or the stoop they called on Charles Street unless I had sleeves on. I just didn't wear it. And it was nothing about, you know, the AME church doesn't tell you that, so it wasn't about holiness, any of that. That was just who I was. So knowing he came from a Pentecostal background, and back they were, well, you know, so anyway, he came, and I remember now, Reverend, I had this dress, and I can see the dress in my mind right now. It was one of those little, it was jewel neckline, had no sleeves, kind of a broomstick like mine. PK, I don't even know what PK is, black PK. And then right around it, it had a gold and a taupe and like a turquoise, and it had all those colors in a rope belt, three of them around the waist. And I said, well, he had to get the victory over my arms tonight because it's hot and I'm in the house. Proposed to me almost the next day.
Wow.
Because he asked my mother that night, may I have your daughter's hand in marriage?
Wow.
Right. I ain't done anything. Okay, they would have to get done with it. Because I wasn't the best person to be talking to, right? I was, whatever. Anyway. And so he only had a sense of humor, and I said this. And he's been gone 20 years, and I can still talk about it like that. And he told the joke to my parents. This fellow came to date this girl, and we got ready to leave. He wasn't leaving, so the father said, anything on your mind, son? And he was stabbing, he said, I want to ask, have your daughter's hand in marriage. He said, what's the matter with the rest of her? And she right away is falling for this. She said, I feel like I've known him all my life. The next day we're going to Coney Island. He's asking where I want to live. I said, we don't want to live. May I tell my mother about you? I said, you don't have anything to tell your mother. I'm serious. That's how I did it. I was going to wait 2 years. I wasn't married anybody. I was working on my master's. I was going out there to Kane, which was Newark State still. And I wouldn't marry anybody because all my friends who got married weren't going back to school and I just wasn't doing it. But one of my friends said, Mary, he's the pastor's friend, Phil Skinner's friend. He said he's a good dresser, he's handsome and everything, all among folk. She said, and he loves you. Why do you have to wait 2 years? She said, won't you give up one of those years and you can get to know him in a year. So I did it okay. So after a while, and the ring that I'm wearing now, and what's so unique about it, I like the marquee. His favorite stores was Macy in New York. And I went to the jeweler, he said, go over and pick out the ring that you like. This was when I said yes, finally said yes. And I picked the ring out, the gentleman put it aside. When O'Hanley came that night, the same ring I put aside was the one he picked. Amen?
Amen.
It was a God thing. So what I'm saying to you, I just was never anxious. It was O'Hanley who was counting days after the wedding. He could always tell me how many more days, because I wasn't counting. But I'm just thanking the Lord for the journey.
Yeah.
I declare a decree in this house that God has plans for you, divine favor rests upon this house. I don't believe it's an accident that I brought this message to you about the prescription for God's favor and blessings. Because all I'm asking you to do is give the Stembridge family the opportunity to serve you. I feel their heart that they want to make it work here in East Orange, and you have a beautiful spirit. When I came to do my event, you were just right here to do all the things that I needed. I do like the atmosphere here. I would like to be able to do some things. So if you give them the chance, this church will be what God would have it to be. And in your own lives, beginning today, what is it that God is saying to you about your children, your relationships? All the other things. You have to do it God's way.
Right.
You can't do it your way.
All right.
2 Chronicles 7:14. If my people will call by my name, will humble themselves and pray, will seek my face, and turn from their wicked ways, then when I hear from heaven, I'll forgive their sin
right.
And heal their land. God bless you.
Amen.